all heard me a few times, but this is a first for my mama. She's never heard me in person, so happy Grandparents Day, mama.
Level of uncleanliness in your life no problem, no circumstance too big that the blood of the Lamb can make it all right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God, my God. He is good. I love that song. Amen. I feel like that's my whole story right there. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Shout out to all the grandparents. Hallelujah. I told Brother Floyd, I talked to him and said, today we're going to celebrate all the old people. And I can say that because in 30 years, I'll be one of you. Emphasis on the 30 years. I am in celebration. I wore my grandmother couch tie today. Everybody can see the tie. You think about grandma's house. That's what I think of. But God is good, and I do love the elders in the church. I'm standing upon the foundation that you've laid, the footers that you've dug. I can only preach behind this pulpit because there are pillars like you here. Yeah. I can remember I did not get prayed through by a bunch of 16-year-old kids, but there were a couple grandmamas that grabbed a hold of me and prayed me through until God washed me and made me whole. Hallelujah. Today I want to preach to you this afternoon out of Acts chapter number 8, if you would turn there with me. This is a passage that I love. I have been in the book of Acts. It has been a kick of mine. I preached out of the 12th chapter just a few weeks back. This has been my homestead. But after all, we are a book of Acts church. I believe in the miracle working power of the book of Acts. We preach the same doctrine. We are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. And Acts chapter number 8, verse number 17, I want to bring to your attention. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. We can still do that in here today if you need it. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of this thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps thou thought of thine heart, may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness, and in the bond of iniquity. Then answered Simon and said, pray ye to the Lord for me. Pray for me, that none of these things which ye have spoken come upon me. And this morning, I want to bring to you a word that I have entitled, you can't buy out a sellout. You can't buy out a sellout. You can be seated across the house. If I could give you a little context to Acts chapter number 8, I would start with the story of one Saul of Tarsus. The great apostle Paul, in whom the latter half of this book highlights, we can find in Acts, it is broken up in three parts. The first six chapters predominantly focus on Peter. And Peter's ministry, he is the central theme and focus. Acts chapter number 7 is broken down by the martyr, Mr. Stephen. And Acts 8 and on, this figure, Saul, or later, Paul, is the central figure. Acts chapter 8 tells the story of this man, Saul, who has wholeheartedly gone after the church. The scripture says he consented with the death of this one preacher by the name of Stephen. This man, Stephen, had preached with fervency and power to the men, and he was stoned to death for preaching the gospel of Christ. And this man saw, and the New Living Translation says, wholeheartedly agree with this. And Saul went from house to house and church to church, shaking men and women out of their homes and putting them into prison. He's taking them and he's destroying the work that God has done. And the saints of God and the people, they are then scattered abroad. They're scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. And that's what gives us the context of why we end up in Samaria in Acts chapter number 8. The story says, as they were scattered, these people preached everywhere. The people of God, they were moved and they were destroyed and their homes were wrecked, but they still found solace in the gospel of Christ. If I can say anything in here, is it just because you've got Jesus in your life doesn't mean everything is going to be roses.
Right.
There will be bumps along the way. There will be trials. There will be tribulations. There will be folks that come at you and persecute you. But the solace is found in the gospel of Christ. The peace of my life is not based upon where I'm at or the circumstances that are around me, but my peace is based upon the confidence in the gospel of Christ. That's what it is. Hallelujah. And if you are better yet, if I could just give one word of advice today, do not base your happiness based on your condition of your life, where you are right now or where you're going to be at tomorrow, but base the happiness of your life and your standing with God. If I've got Jesus, I've got everything. Hallelujah. What profit of a man gain the whole world and lose his soul? You can have this whole world, but give me Jesus. The grandma and grandpas used to sing, you can have this whole world, but just give me Jesus. I don't need a mansion on the hills. I don't need a Cadillac to drive. I don't need gators on my feet or a body suit. I just need Jesus. I don't have to have all this world has to offer, but if I've got Jesus, I've got everything. Somebody have that testimony in your life. Everything that may not be peachy, Jesus working in my life. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Woo. That is loving. Hallelujah. Being as the saints of God, they're scattered. They are preaching this idea. You can have this whole world, but I got me some Jesus. And in particular, this passage, it begins to talk about the man Philip, the preacher man. He goes to this area in Samaria, and I don't know if I've been doing this a ton, but today I'm just preaching Acts 8. Is that okay? I don't got anything fancy. We just preaching word today. Hallelujah. And he is going to this area. He is there, and he is preaching. The scripture says they preached everywhere. Hallelujah. And in verse 5, it says, Philip went down to the city of Samaria, and he preached Christ unto them. You know, this is the fun part about this story. Philip comes to this area of Samaria. He begins to preach Christ to these people. But these people already have a so-called preacher in the midst. They have been calling this man the Great One, that surely he has the power of God operating. And this whole town has been bewitched by the sorceries of one man by the name of Simon. Most biblical historians, or when we talk about this guy, we call him Simon the Sorcerer. And Philip comes into Samaria and he begins to preach Christ, and things begin to happen. Immediately, the people are in one accord and they give heed to what Peter says. They begin to hear his preaching and they see the miracles that are performed. Unclean spirits are crying with loud voices. Devils are coming out of folks. Folks with the palsy are healed. The lame begin to walk, and there is great joy in the city. God begins to move. But if I could say today, in a modern context, we fight battles just like Philip did in Samaria. This area is overrun with wicked ideology. There are thought processes and mentalities in place of these people. And when he begins to preach Christ, the chains that have them bound psychologically begin to fall. Modern ministry, we war against gripping thoughts and mindsets. We war against people that have offense and moral perversion and spirits and mindsets of laziness and complacency. When I preach from the pulpit, I'm fighting welfare mindsets. I'm fighting unconfident men. I'm fighting bold and outspoken people. And my main objective in most cases when we preach the gospel, I'm not focusing on changing a man's attire. I don't care as much about changing your habits or your character immediately. But if I can change the way that you think, something can happen for you. In Romans chapter number 12 and verse number 1, we find this same idea. This is the Apostle Paul. The one that I said was persecuting the church and was the forerunner for this story. He writes this: I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Verse 2. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I said, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. If I can change the way a man processes things up here, I can show him what is good and acceptable in the sight of God. Ministry means I'm aiding his personal development. I'm teaching him to be more than what his mind says he can be. The apostle, hey, I felt this there, and I'm going to take this to heart. I'm going to preach this to young people for a minute. Paul said, let no man despise thy youth. Hey, and I'm 28, so they think I'm young too. You don't think I'm young, but they do. A lot of my ministry has been working with people older than me. People in their early 30s, mid-30s, early 40s. And you have to work with men to teach them how to work and keep a job, how to handle money, how to trust other people, how to sometimes parent and be a dad. You're working to change the way they think and perceive the world. But young folks, I want you to catch this here. Nehemiah, I want you to hear me, son. You can impact how someone views a church service just by how you act. You can change the way a man thinks. Every time a word gets preached from the pulpit and you have a loud amen, you're changing the process in which is going forward as he's receiving the word. When Sister Ray is leading worship and your hands go in the air and the man looks, he then begins to think, that's how I'm supposed to respond to God. Every time you shout, every time you praise God, you're changing the mindset of a man that is bound. I am transforming the man's mind by my worship. We are transforming the heart of a broken man by the calling and the response to the gospel of Christ. My amen says, let it be so. That word can speak in your heart. All right, preacher, preach it high. It's a response. You can preach a solid word of deliverance in my heart, and I will see. Young person, you can teach an old whippersnapper how to get a hold of God all over again. You can do it. It's okay to worship loud. It's It's okay to get a hold of God. You can do it. Hallelujah. When I talked to Levi at home, we've been talking about consistency in our life. We want consistent worship in all avenues of our life. And I used the example of my hands. These hands are not all that pretty. They're not. They got scars on them, they've got warts, they've got calluses. But the same hands that I work with on a job site, that touch hard lumber and broken pipe and shovels and pegs and sometimes gross things that we don't need to talk about, these same hands are the ones that show love and affection to my wife. These same hands I throw catch with my little boy. These same hands can be utilized to worship God. What I'm saying is, don't get some one-track mind where you think you can only do one thing with what you have. The same hands that I love my family with and I make an earning with are the hands that lift up and praise the God of God at all stars. I've got to change the way I think. These hands just ain't for making money. These hands just ain't for playing catch with my boy. But these hands are for giving offerings to God. They're giving sacrifices of praise. My hands. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I come to let somebody know today you are more than what they told you you are. You are more than your socioeconomic status. You're more than what your mama was. You're more than your letdowns. You're more than who your daddy wasn't in your life. It's time for you to change how you think about yourself. You are bold. You are powerful. You are a... The Bible says you are a peculiar people. You are God's chosen select and divine. Anointed and bold and powerful generation. You just gotta believe that you are. And Acts 10, you'll find a checklist. This is our revival checklist. Is God moving in the situation? We go down the list in Acts 8. The palsy are healed. Check. The lame is healed. Check. Devils are cast out. Check. Christ is being preached. Check. Joy has filled the city. Check. Hey, this is a big thing here. God, I love that God does miracles. I love to see people get healed. I love to see like the lame healed, the palsy healed. I love to see Christ preach. But we should have joy in our church. We should have, if you've got victory and miracles in your church, we should be a smiling church. You should have a smile on. We should have frowns in here. You should all be smiling real big with all the teeth that you legally own. If you bought them, they're yours. You paid for them. You got to smile. That was all time. But can I say, though, this is my second point. This man, Philip, goes into the city and he preaches Christ. When Jesus is preached with anointing, signs and wonders will always accompany. Always. Because Jesus is not without miracles. He's not. Philip went down and he preached Christ. Verse 6 says, nothing fancy, no educated word, but just Jesus. And I can say with confidence today, if we preach Jesus, his miracles and his power will follow. When he preached Jesus, healing happened. When he preached Jesus, uncleanliness came out of people. When Jesus was preached, joy was found. If we want people to be more than what they are, we preach Jesus. Yes. I always find it fun that a lot of the miracles that are mentioned in the New Testament, specifically the book of Acts, is full of miracles that deal with people with palsy,
and folks that are lame. We understand that if a man is lame, he is unable to walk right. In most cases, he's unable to walk at all. And a man that is bound with palsy, he's lost bodily function. He just can't control himself anymore. And this is the ministry that we have. We're dealing with folks that have lost control of their life. They're unable to walk on their own. They've lost the ability to get here and to get there. They're struggling and they're broken. If we could just preach Jesus, they can find a walk that'll hold them to the end. And as the revival takes place here in the city of Samaria, these people, their miracles are happening. Great joy is filled the city. These people receive the preaching of Philip, and they are baptized in the name of Jesus. Even that guy, Simon the sorcerer, the dude who had the city under wraps, he gets baptized in the name of Jesus. He gives heed, and he receives the word. And you know what happens? Anytime revival's going down, it gets noise to abroad. And it gets back to headquarters. Peter and John, they hear that Philip is down having some revival in Samaria. God is moving down there. And the apostles hear, and they send Peter and John down to preach to these men. Because yes, miracles have happened. Yes, signs and wonders and healings have happened. People have been baptized. But the Holy Ghost has not yet been poured out. This will give you some notion here real quick. The greatest miracle that can ever take place in a Book of Acts church is when the Holy Ghost is poured out. That's it. It's our big miracle. We think it's every day happening. It's like manna from heaven, sis. It happens all the time. Every day, there's a new sustenance that comes in. Holy Ghost operation is just normal for us. But can I say, it's still that same renewing power that changed you. The same spirit that rose Christ from the dead dwells in you, and it quickens your mortal body. It's that Holy Ghost power. And, and he comes down, and he says that these guys that come down, and they're preaching the word, they're preaching hot, they're preaching hard, and they begin to lay hands on the people. I still believe in laying hands on folks. And they begin to lay hands on these people. And an emphatic experience takes place. These men and women, these people, they receive the Holy Ghost in Samaria. God is moving. There's such a dramatic outside experience. There's a physical response that takes place, so much to the soul that this Simon the sorcerer, he sees that by the laying on of the hands of the ministry of the apostles, that the Holy Ghost is given. He sees, I know this ain't new for him, this ain't new, but he sees this. And if anything here I can say, this church, I know we preach truth, oneness. I believe in the oneness of the Godhead. I believe in the apostolic doctrine. We are based upon scriptural reference and foundation. But no matter what we say in this room, a lot of us are still rooted on the experience that happened to us. I am rooted in an encounter at an apostolic altar that changed my life forever. There was a physical change in me that day because Jesus got in on the inside and it showed on the outside. If there's ever a time in which we know that God does something, when the old song says, Jesus on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life. When you can see the physical change on the outside, you know God's done some work on the inside. And I was delivered at an apostolic altar. The drugs were left at the altar, and I walked in the newness of life. Oh, somebody, addiction had me bound, but it was left behind. That was an experience with God. Hallelujah. It forever changed my life. Something about the power of the Holy Ghost. I can't explain it, but I got it. Oh, hallelujah. And this man, Simon, he sees this power. He comes to the apostles. And he says, I would like to buy this power. I got me a bill right here. I want to buy the power that when I lay hands on somebody, they get the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you right now, it would take a whole lot more than a $20 bill. But it says, I want to buy this power. The apostles, oh, they're taken back. They're upset. Peter rebukes them openly, and that's what we read today in our text. He says, you have no lot in this matter. You ain't even got a seat at the table. God's power, it can't be bought. The anointing of God, it can't be purchased. God's presence, his miracle working presence, it can't be made or manufactured. Your talent can't buy God's favor. Your charisma can't get you a preaching call. Your looks won't get God's attention in time of need. But this power of God, it cannot be bought. Because the power of God was already paid for by his blood at the cross. That blood washes you and your dirty rags can't be too dirty. That same blood that washed you whole, purchased. It just can't be bought. Oh, hallelujah. And this man is distraught. Peter says, you can't buy this power. Because God is not looking for a buyout. He's looking for a seller. God's looking for somebody that will sell out totally to him. That will give all their talent. That will give their personality, their charisma, their money, their looks, their youth, their time. I'll give it all to you, God, and you can be a worker of Christ. The man that repents and seeks God diligently with his whole heart is a worker of God's power. He's looking for a repentant, a selfless man that's quit the sin in business. That's who he wants to work for. Oh, hallelujah. Help us, Lord. Hallelujah. Why don't you stand across this place and pray with Jesus? Sister, now, I want you to pull up verse number 24 for me. Let's go verse number, number 24 there. He tells this man, Peter rebukes Simon. He says, you need to repent. Your heart is full of wickedness. You're full of iniquity. Your life is a mess. You can have no lot in working for God's power. This man tried to purchase the power and the anointing and the work of God. If I can ever give any piece of advice today, your good looks, your charm, your smile, your charisma, your talent, I don't care how good you sing, I don't care how good you play a musician, I don't care how much money's in your bank account. You cannot buy his grace. You cannot buy God's mercy. You cannot purchase his redemption. The only way you can get it is when you sell out. Your purchasing power is not in how much finance you have, but in how quickly you're willing to sell what you have.
Help us, God. Help us here today.
I'm selling out my motives. I get it figured out that I just can't do it on my own. I can't make heaven by myself. I'm not good enough. I wasn't worthy of his mercy or his grace. I sold out. I sell out my addiction. I sell out the bondage in my life. And then I can be a worker of his power. Peter tells this man all these rebuking things. He says, it's not going to go good, but you got to get a hold of God and repent, and he'll do a work for you. But just like modern ministry, we preach hard, we tell you what it is, and this is this man's response. Mr. Big Shot, Simon the Sorcerer, the one that had the town under his control, he answers and said, pray ye to the Lord for me.
Pray for me.
Pray for me. He missed it. The preacher said, just repent. Get a hold of God for yourself. And it'll be, maybe he'll forgive the thought that came for you. On a grandparent's day like this, I can say this with confidence. Grandma and grandpa's faith can't do it for you. Mama and daddy's faith can't do it for you. Brother Romine and Sister Romine's anointing can't do it for you. Sister Ray can't. Brother Browning, no one else in here can do it but you. I can pray for God's power in your life. I can pray for God to touch you. I can pray that God does something. But eventually, you've got to sell out yourself. Pray to the Lord for me. It's time that you quit relying on other folks. It's time that you get a hold of it for yourself. Oh, somebody. Hey, God's power is not for sale. You can't buy it. But your earnest prayers and your cry out to God, he will freely give his anointing and his grace. God's grace is for free. His mercy is for free. He will forgive those that don't deserve it. But if you would, somebody, it's time that you realize he's looking for a sellout today. It's time that you sell out your personal appearance. It's time you sell out yourself and say, I'm ready to be a worker in the kingdom. I'm ready to see God perform miracles in my life. I'm ready to see God change me from the inside out. I can't do it on my own, God. It's time. Oh, hallelujah. Why don't we just gather up front here today?
Lord, my God.
Yes, we're getting ready to sing a song. And I want you to do this. I want you to wake up and smell the coffee. Your time to sell out is now. Do what the old timer said. Make your calling and election sure. Somebody in here, why don't you just make your mind up right now? I can't do it for you. We got a busing Sunday school bus route. We're doing it. We're trying to help you. We get you here. But it's time for you to do it. Come on, grandma and grandpa. It's time. Come on. We're calling out. It's here. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah.